वेलकम एवरीवन टू द सेशन. इज क्वालिटी रियली एवरीवन्स रिस्पांसिबिलिटी? द क्वालिटी अकाउंटेबिलिटी कनंड्रम बाय दीपक कॉल.
थैंक यू. हेलो एवरीवन, माय नेम इज दीपक एंड टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू प्रेजेंट इज क्वालिटी रियली एवरीवन्स रिस्पांसिबिलिटी. देयर इज दिस क्वालिटी अकाउंटेबिलिटी कनंड्रम व्हिच वी रेगुलरली फेस एज टेस्टर्स. सो आई विल थ्रो सम लाइट ऑन इट. About me, I spent 2007 to 2012, 5 years in PTC, and then around 8.5 years in Red Hat. I'm still working in Red Hat as a quality engineering manager. I'm also running a Ministry of Testing QE meetup for Pune City. This is about me. I love psychology. I'm a bit of a psychology buff, and I also love some comedy. I do memes and everything. So you'll probably notice that going forward in this. All right. So the thing I'd like to start with is that responsibility aversion is something which is very intrinsic to human nature. So for an example, when you buy a pack of potato wafers from outside, you see this sign, right? This sign, keep your city clean. Keeping our city clean is a universal truth, right? Everyone should keep their city clean. But it is such a statement, just like quality is everyone's responsibility, that it does not mean that each one of us is intrinsically inclined to keep our city clean, right? Unless that's why we have these signs that when you eat a pack of chips or wafers, you have to throw that pack into a trash can and not throw that in a road. So they clearly know that we won't be throwing the trash into a trash can. That's why these symbols are there. And in an alternate example, if you remember back in the days, we had this Selenium users Google group, right? So what happened was back in I think 2010, when somebody used to send a problem to Selenium users Google group, whose responsibility do you think it was to reply to that person? Right? Nobody's. It was everyone's responsibility who were part of that emailing list. But eventually, if you sent out a request to that group and you did not get an answer for maybe 2 weeks, then nobody was actually responsible for that, right? So it was not something that you could actually expect people to respond, because there was no responsibility there. Whoever was responding to your questions was doing in good faith and trying to help you out. But there is no concept of responsibility when the whole responsibility is laid down on a group and there is no accountability principle. Nobody is going to hold me accountable for not responding to someone's request on Selenium user Google group or any other maybe Stack Overflow or any other thing, right? So the first thing we learn is that we as humans try to avert responsibility, as because it is very natural and evolutionary, so we cannot do anything about it. The second thing is about quality. When we talk about quality in a broader context of things, qualities, we have been interchangeably using quality with testing. Even my job title is quality manager, right? But it's not actually quality of the software. What we do is just the testing of the software, not the overall quality. Quality is a huge term, right? So Jerry Weinberg back in I think 1940s gave the definition of quality as fit for use or something which provides value to someone. And that definition was then extended by other testing experts as value to someone who matters, right? This is the definition of quality in a software context. It's not something which a test engineer can wholly and solely own, right? It has to be divided across the organization, not just the engineering teams, but across the organization. So in their book called Peopleware, I think Tory Moore mentioned mentioned that and remarked that quality might be equal to chocolate sauce on a Sunday, right? And it is totally stakeholder driven. So if your customers are demanding X amount of chocolate sauce, you provide them X amount of chocolate sauce. And if some customers like more chocolate sauce, you give them more chocolate sauce and eventually increase the cost as well. So if it was not the case, so I will give you a simple example of quality not related to success. So if you look at lot of movies with glaring potholes and bad acting, bad music and everything, they're still very successful. But what can explain that? How are movies, if we think of movies and an analogy of softwares, right? How are movies with bad acting, bad storylines and everything bad about them, every technical aspect is totally ridiculous, and then still they go ahead and make millions at the box office. Why is that? And what about, how would you explain India's top selling cars, right? The Maruti cars. So if you take any global crash test, they just fail spectacularly there. And then if you look at the top 10 selling cars in India, you'll find top five of those spots are held by Maruti cars. So if Maruti Alto was a software and I was a testing engineer, I'll punch its bonnet and tell my project manager that I don't think you can ship it, right? It's just 0.2 mm of steel. It would be very dangerous for the users, right? I'll try to become an obstructive tester, not getting that thing released into market, which my company already knows that is already a successful model, right? They don't need to test more quality into their product. They know it is a successful product. So the point I'm trying to make is that overall quality of a product, including software, depends on a lot of factors. One is pricing, right? What if you make a great software which has great accessibility, very minute bugs, and you have done almost all great things as a testing team, but your company decides that they'll price it higher than their competitors, and then it does not become so successful. What about your sales engineers and other marketing people? They did a poor job, and now your software, which was a great software, does not work. What about after sales support, consumption models? What if your company is trying to sell a software as a five-year license model and not a very small bite-sized consumption model, right? There are multiple factors. We decide the success and actually the quality of the software rather than testing. So the point I'm trying to make is that as testers, we should not think that we are the safety net around the software and its quality. Okay, so what did we learn so far? Responsibility aversion, right? Members of a team are not instinctively inclined for quality accountability. They are not. Nobody is, not just software teams. Anybody in this world, if you tell me that this is a village or a city and its citizens are totally inclined as a group, they are totally inclined and accountable, I'll not believe in that. The second thing which we learned is that quality is relative. Great testing does not mean great quality, because everything is not under a tester's control. Your software's pricing models and after sales support and lots of other stuff. The third thing is software development, which most of us do, right? Most of us do, is not science. 90% of the software which we create is not even high tech. It is social software development. Sitting in a garage and creating Linux is high tech software development, but using that Linux to write a Python script is not. Creating Kubernetes or Ansible is high tech, but using Ansible playbooks to spawn a VM is not. Right? That is you are just making your life easy using existing tools and high tech technology, but to make sure that you are helping a business by providing them some functionality or features, right? So based on all of this, the burning question is, in burning question as in Arnav Goswami's words, if quality is relative and value to someone, how can testers find that out, right? So we think about shift left testing, right? We want to start early as people are trying to gather requirements and everything. But is that the actual early we want to start, or can we go farther left? So I want to take this platform to announce that there is a way to go farther left. So you just don't shift left, you shift extreme left. So if you are a flat earther, you will probably fall down off the edge of the earth, so left. So shift extreme left means you go to a point where you know that why on the earth is this company, is my organization putting valuable resources and money and so much effort into creating a software? Are we replacing a human? Let's think about this platform, right? This platform on which we are doing this Selenium conference today. I think I haven't seen a platform like this ever before, right? So a group of people created this software for us, right? What were they doing? Were they replacing a monolithic software? No. Were they replacing a legacy app? No. Was it a completely new blue ocean idea? Yes, probably. I haven't seen, because I haven't heard about any other conference platform like this. And were they replacing a human? Yes, because earlier in 2016 and 18, I used to go to Mahesh Lunch Home in Bangalore and have lunch. Today, I have to cook my own lunch while using this software, right? So yes, we replaced human. This software has replaced all human interaction in a physical way to a virtual way. But that is the motive, right? You understand the strategy of the company who built this software. So you have to, if you want to go extreme left, you have to understand the strategy at organization level. Why is our company putting so much money and effort into this software? At our department level, if I am from an engineering department or maybe an R&D department, what is my department strategy? Where does this strategy fit into my organization strategy? And what is my team strategy, the very micro level strategy of my team? And what is expected from my team? And once you start doing this, because each one of you, let's say you are in this 3 to 5 or 3 to 7 years of experience doing testing and doing test automation, solving XPath versus CSS problems. But 5 years down the line, it's not going to remain the same, right? You have to grow in your roles, and each one of you has to probably go into more, to solve bigger problems than XPath versus CSS, right? And the most amazing byproduct of understanding your company strategy and aligning your testing to that strategy is that you automatically become very, very sticky to the company's culture and company's growth. That means your growth as well. So OKR is one model. So I won't go into detail, but I think as individuals, OKR is something which is used in most of the organizations as a strategy communication versus focus tool. So try to find out what your OKRs are for your team, for your department, and for your company as well. And this is. Mm-hmm. Okay. So this is the accountability model I'm talking about. So as testers, I encourage you all to not be the obstructionist testers, right? You are not here to break the software in those technical terms. You are here to help software release on time by building a context of what quality means for your company and your customers, right? So this CRED model is something which I like you all to read and probably implement at your end. So the summary, what we learned today is that go to the root of the purpose of building a software, right? Extreme left, as I said. Build context to quality. As I said, testing is not equal to quality. You need to know where the fine line between quality and testing lies. If you are crossing that line, then you will be termed as a tester who is very obstructionist and does not help the team release the software on time, right? As per the CREED model, your job is just to recommend what can be the better quality measures for your software, but not fight for them, right? You cannot fight for those. See, it is you must have read in blogs and books, it is a very common, almost a conventional wisdom right now that a tester needs to be very persistent and needs to fight for its bugs and stuff like that. I think that is just ridiculous. It should not be like that. In an agile team, we should not think of ourselves as someone who is actually there to break the software or to stop the release because it does not meet my personal gating criteria, right? So that you should align yourself to your team's purpose and not follow your separate purpose of quality. So the shared quality vision of your team, including you, must match what the quality vision of your company is. Right? That is the golden area in which you want to stay as a tester.
Thank you once again, Deepak, for your time and for sharing your wisdom with us.